From coast to coast, people are fleeing flames, wind, and water.
They're very dangerous conditions, and in 22 years of doing this, I've never seen fire conditions like we're seeing now.
The Calder Fire has forced tens of thousands of people in the South Lake Tahoe area to evacuate. It's the 15th largest wildfire in California history. And out of the largest 20 California fires, 11 of them happened in the last 5 years. Up the coast, the Pacific Northwest saw a record-breaking heat wave earlier in the summer.
The Red Cross traditionally doesn't support cooling centers, but this is unfortunately our new normal. This is the first time it was 116 degrees. It won't be the last time.
In the South, people are displaced from Hurricane Ida, which arrived on the 16th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina. And in the Northeast,
we are in a whole new world now. Let's be blunt about it.
The remnants of Ida brought flash flooding and tornadoes to areas that rarely saw these events in the past.
The records that were broken in Central Park, for example, 3.15 inches in 1 hour. It broke a record literally set 1 week earlier. That says to me that there are no more cataclysmic, unforeseeable events.
In August, the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change said it is, quote, unequivocal that humans have caused the climate crisis. The report confirms that widespread and rapid changes have already happened, some of them irreversibly. A lead author of that report, Kim Cobb, explains how the Earth has warmed more than 1 degree Celsius since pre-industrial levels.
We've, of course, known for decades that rise in fossil fuel emissions are driving warming across the planet. This warming is related to the heating of the atmosphere that has caused a 7% increase in the amount of water vapor that the atmosphere can hold.
More water vapor leads to higher humidity, in some areas more drought.
We've had drought cycles, but this is the first time we've ever seen a mega drought where it's year after year.
And in other areas, a potential for more rainfall and more frequent heavy rainstorms. With oceans retaining more heat, hurricanes can get stronger, slower, and wetter. And Ida was a prime example of those changes. With every fraction of a degree of warming, the effects get worse.
If we think this is bad, we have to get ready for the climate of the next decades when we know we have a couple tenths of a degree warming more.
In the UN report's most optimistic scenario, the world's emissions need to drop sharply, beginning now, to net zero carbon emissions by 2050. Even then, we'll peak above a dangerous warming threshold before falling again.
I know you've heard a number of prominent voices on certain media outlets that have mocked the connection that experts such as yourself have made between these extreme weather events and climate change. So for those that are still skeptical about the effects of climate change, what's your message? How do we know that these fires and hurricanes are a result of a warming planet?
Yeah, thanks, Boris. It's good to be with you. And the science here is very solid. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC, which you mentioned in their latest report, really connected the dots in a way that previous reports hadn't. And in large part, it has to do with the level of sophistication of the science now, where we can do what's known as detection and attribution. It's a fancy way of saying we can do sort of a before-after comparison with the climate models. We run the climate models without the increase in carbon pollution from fossil fuel burning, and we run the same models including that increase in carbon pollution. And we see how often a particular extreme event happens in both cases. And in many of the cases that you're talking about, what we see is that the event is observed to have been astronomically unlikely without the additional warming from human activity. And in the models that include that, we find that these sorts of events are likely to happen. And here's the bad news. What we're seeing now, the models tell us, is baked in. That's what we're going to have to deal with now for years to come. It gets worse if we don't reduce carbon emissions dramatically in the years ahead.
So, Michael, you lay out the science, and it's clear that there's a backing for the arguments that you're making. Stepping aside from your expertise and your experience as a scientist, as a human being, it has to be incredibly frustrating for you to point this out and to be sounding the alarm for decades, and yet there doesn't seem to be the urgency among leadership that is required to meet the moment.
Yeah, and you know, there is a certain level of frustration in seeing your predictions come true. As a climate scientist, the worst thing that can happen is to watch our predictions come true, because decades ago, literally, you know, 30 years ago, the scientific community had already come to the conclusion that we could see the impact of human-caused climate change, and it would get much worse if we didn't take action. And now, you know, decades later, we're saying the same thing. And now what we mean by action is a dramatically different thing. If we had acted decades ago, we could have brought our carbon emissions down fairly gently. We could have sort of gradually moved away from fossil fuels. Now, in order to prevent a truly catastrophic warming of the planet of more than 3 degrees Fahrenheit, we have to bring our carbon emissions down by a factor of 50% within the next 10 years. And that's going to require a monumental effort on our part. There's some signs of progress. The United States has made a very bold pledge to bring its carbon emissions down by that amount within the next 10 years. Other leaders from other countries are now coming to the table. The United States is once leading again on this issue, and that's making a real difference. But there's still a gap between what countries are promising and the policies that they have in place, what we call an implementation gap. We're still building new fossil fuel infrastructure. When the conservative International Energy Agency has told us that if we are to avert catastrophic warming of the planet, there can be no new fossil fuel infrastructure, no new pipelines, no new coal-fired power plants.
And Michael, paint a picture for us of what the future looks like. If what we're seeing now is this Category 5 hurricane that floods Louisiana and then winds up also flooding the Northeast, what can we expect with that 3-degree shift that you were talking about?
Yeah, if we warm the planet more than a degree and a half Celsius or 3 degrees Fahrenheit, then we know these storms will become even more intense, even more damaging, because there's a pretty basic physical relationship. The energy that intensifies these storms and provides them with all this moisture that leads to the flooding rainfall that we've seen comes from the heat content of the ocean. And the heat content of the ocean this year was higher than any other year. That extra heat is fueling these stronger storms. And, you know, this storm almost, if it had a little bit longer, would have become a Cat 5 storm. It would have landfalled as a Category 5 storm. Here's the thing. We are going to need to define new categories. Category 6 storms, storms with winds of 200 miles per hour or greater sustained. Arguably, that's a Category 6 storm, and we're already starting to see those.
Michael, there is intense debate on Capitol Hill, not just between Democrats and Republicans, but even within the Democratic Party about the urgency with which to approach the issue of climate change. What's your message to lawmakers?
Yeah, I would say there are a couple stragglers right now in the Democratic Party. In order to get meaningful climate action, unfortunately, Republicans are unwilling to act. Democrats are going to get that legislation through on a purely partisan basis, and that's going to mean all 50 Democrats voting for this reconciliation package that has meaningful climate action. The infrastructure bill itself right now is very skimpy when it comes to the central challenge we face, the climate crisis. But the reconciliation bill would provide a whole lot more funding for renewable energy. It would provide incentives in the form of what's known as a clean power portfolio standard, which would require utilities to meet up to 80% of their electricity generation from renewables alone within a decade or so. So we need real climate policy in the form of legislation that will codify some of the things that the administration is trying to do through executive actions. Executive actions by the Biden administration alone aren't going to be enough. We need climate legislation, and we need that infrastructure package to pass Congress with climate action intact.